Where to this together?
I somehow drifted toward machine learning kinds of stuff. I think trying to keep some interesting basic things. We'll talk about machine learning. Machine learning is something that really changed at least one area of science completely, image processing. Many problems mentioned in the first talks about convex optimization, TV regularization, and so on. There are standard tools in convex optimization. There are standard applied problems in convex optimization solved by many beautiful algorithms. There are books, there is a Michael Lellard whose citation is here. This is a very well known Israeli professor. He has a very good book about linear algebra matrix methods for image processing, SVD-based, and so on. And people were working on that for like years, but then some guys came, put some black box thing on it for image debugging problem, and it worked at the same quality, in some cases even better than the best algorithm developed by using beautiful mathematical tools. So it's a little bit disturbing, right? You work for many, many years, and then black box thing just outperforms it. Right? Doesn't mean that almost that was before. But if you think about the value of the tools that you use, of course they have some value, but it also means that there should be some mathematics behind learning this kind of thing. But what we can safely say that there is no sufficient mathematical foundations behind deep learning almost at every step. Right? So for example, if you look at classical statistical machine learning thing, okay, I will not talk about it. So I will briefly mention it in the end, but there is of course very nice statistical learning theory, but if you apply modern deep learning architecture, maybe this theory just provides estimates that are completely useless. So there are no good generalization bounds and so on. So I think this is a big challenge to the mathematical community. Why these methods work so well? That's one thing. Try to provide some reasonable explanation. And the second thing is, of course, if this approach works quite well, why it cannot be applied to the image processing or maybe to solve the partial differential equations or to finding new optimization methods or so to and actually, the general concept behind deep learning and machine learning was what we got. And it's a cheap recipe, a cookbook, how to make a paper about deep learning if you are not working in deep learning, right? Doing deep something. So, what you do, you have some software algorithm that works quite well, but maybe it's slow, or maybe you want to improve its performance. and then you say, okay, every software. So every code is just a combination of certain functions, right? So it's just a superposition of simple functions. Every program is of simple functions. And typically, okay, except for difficult cases, these functions are differential. So your program is just a differentiable function which takes something as an input and produces something as an output. And the parameters of this of your algorithm, they are defined by some a priori knowledge, by smart choice and so on, but maybe there is a better choice. So what you do, you say, okay, I have an input, you have an answer that I want my algorithm to get, and then I just optimize over the parameter of my algorithm. I want to find a better algorithm. If I have a parameterized form of my algorithm, I have an input and output, then I just optimize, and since this is a typically superposition of simple functions, okay, this is a non-convex problem, that is that you have to use stochastic techniques and so on. But generally, and if you already have a good algorithm, so probably you have a good initial choice. And you optimize from this point and you get a better solution. Of course, but this is completely non-convex in every step. It may overfit a lot. We may prepare it here a good training set as a very is a difficult choice, but still this is how many, many papers are published right now. So people working in quantum chemistry, they take quantum chemistry software, provide a set of training oracles and put there the deep neural network on top and say, okay, I have machine learning, deep whatever, published papers in Nature and Science. The problem here for this type of application is whether it fits a lot. For example, for molecules that are in the training set, it works very well, but if you come up with molecules that were not or have different properties, you get absolutely different answers. So there are many problems, but there are a lot of papers. And they're also doing stuff like that, of course, to get interesting results in different situations. But this is actually, in fact, an approximation of multivariate function. So you have a training set, and you sample it somehow. An interesting problem is how you find this sampling points in such a way that your function will be approximated. So this is designed as an experiment, so that you can evaluate your function in a limited number of points, where you have to evaluate to fit your model. And the model can be a tensor model, can be a deep neural network, it can be a parameterized program. And then you have to design some sort of loss function such that you can and approximation. So in the image processing, classification is a typical task. You want to find out whether this is a cat or a dog. So the output is binary or categorical variable. In regression, when we talk about smooth function approximation, this is typically L2 loss, maybe plus something. So this is familiar topical function interpolation, but not too many positive results in all of multivariate function. I'm going to show you stuff from the connection between tensors and deep neural networks that we are working on right now. And show there is a very interesting and simple connection, but it's how it's connected. To show that actually some sort of neural networks are in fact tensor dependent. So we have a classification problem, so we have the set of inputs, X, which we organize in terms of block vector. And you have the true labels that you want to approximate. Let me just show by explain by an example. So you have an image, and you split it into patches. Right? So here you have 16 patches for an image. And then you step each page into a vector. Right? So, this is, so you represent an image as 16 vectors. 16 vectors. And then we'll get a 16-dimensional tensor. That's how we do that. So we introduce what is typically called a feature map. So a feature map maps from n is the size of a patch. Maybe for the animal, we don't know how many pixels are there. This is from this. So this is some function that maps from the vector space of dimension of the number of pixels in a patch to some feature space. And the typical choice is just a linear transformation plus a simple one unit. So for example, you can create such a feature map. And then, given your input image, you can define a tensor. So for each image, I define a tensor, feature tensor, which is just the rank one product of features for each individual. And then when a score function that is given to the paper by another point and show, they can be written in the score. This is just a scalar product of this very large tensor. Right? So here's a 16-dimensional tensor, and the size of the feature map is 10, so it's a virtual tensor of size with 10 to the power 16 elements. But then you take a scalar product, this is a linear model with a tensor. And of course, if we just do not put any constraints on this tensor. Do not put any constraints on the tensor. This model is useless. But then what we do, and we did it many times in many cases, we just put low-rank constraints on this tensor. And putting different low-rank constraints on the tensor, we actually get different types of neural networks. That's the connection between those. So this is, of course, a special type of neural networks. So for example, if we use canonical decomposition that was already mentioned before, so this is the sum of rank one terms. So rank one tensor is the product of rank outer product of vectors, and you take the sum. So this looks like, okay, this is the picture drawn by the group. But still, what you do, you put I1, I2, I3 here, you get vectors of length r, then you just multiply these vectors. This is analogous, if you know about pooling, this is analogous of pooling operations. So here we use product pooling. You take two vectors and you take the element wise product. And then you sum and you get the energy. So this is actually, if this is a multilinear union, so this is just a shallow vector because it only has one layer. The difference between shallow and deep in this case is just one layer basically. If you put H stacking forward, you can figure out that this is equivalent to the composition of bilinear vectors. So you get two vectors here, and this is a bilinear unit which takes two vectors and outputs a vector by a bilinear vector. Maybe there is okay, there is a theorem of Kolmogorov that every function of many variables can be represented as a superposition of continuous functions. So here we approximate a function by composition of bilinear functions. This is not a very wide class. It's not every kind of continuous function. But if you put the bound, maybe not true. But still, that's how if you put H packet, hierarchical packet constraint on the weight tensor in this model, you just get the deep network. And the number of layers here is the network. And this is just by any if you put tensor train decomposition, so tensor train you just take the product of guys that depend on one variable. The first one is a row and the last one is a column. Just refer to the top of the image. You get what is called, what is also known as. What is called recurrent neural network. It has linear structure, so you take this here, this guy outputs a vector, takes another vector here, and so these are also bilinear. So this is a recurrent neural. Okay, now it's actually some picture drawing, it doesn't have any deep mathematical results behind it. Okay, this is just the fact that if you take such kind of units, you get a specific type of neural. But you can actually prove some results based on the fact that these are bilinear units, and all these representations, they're actually polynomial in the variable. And so for polynomial, you have some nice properties from algebraic geometry. And there is a nice result, which was motivated by the result by Koitin and Chashua, based on so-called expressive power. So by that we mean, if you have, for example, a tensor of canonical rank R, then it can be represented with a tensor train with the ranks bounded by R. This is a very simple result. But the true is it opposite. If you have the tensor train with ranks R, so it's a recurrent architecture. What is the size of the canonical rank that you can represent? And this, okay, the question about CP rank is a bit hard, but you can prove results about the measure of the set. So you can prove that if you are given a random tensor with the ranks R and all n, with probability one, this tensor will have exponentially random much easier. And it seems to be difficult results taking into account many PhD dissertations on canonical rank and so on, but in fact it's very simple. In order to show that, you actually have to look at matricization of the tensor. So you have to take the tensor and reshape it by permuting indices and merging indices into a matrix. So you have a matricization, and if you have the CP rank, then for any matricization, the rank is less than R. And in order to show that this guy with probability 1 has exponentially is exponentially large, you actually have to show that at least for one matricization with probability 1, this rank has to be exponentially large. And how to do that? So that's our theorem. That's the proof. So that we have an achievement. And the set of intersection of the set tensors with T rank bounded by R and the set of canonical rank less than Q to the power D over 2 has effect measures. Has effect measures. Zero, this actually the office upon expense. The probability is one that will have exponentially large rank. And the proof is based on the fact that this is all algebraic varieties. And you have to first prove that every element of the set has rank bounded by this exponentially large number. And then you only have to show one particular example one particular example that it has this exponential rank. And this is enough to show that with probability 1, it has exponential rank. So the proof is very easy. You actually have to prove upper bound first, and then to show there is one example. And since these are all polynomial constraints, this red constraints, which are some conditions of the determinants, these are all polynomial constraints, system of polynomial equations, and if a polynomial system of polynomial equations has at least one point where they are all not zero, it means with probability 1, it's also not zero. So, as a fact, it makes the theorem very trivial in the sense you have to find the proof, the example of the tensor. And you actually take the tensor with the following course, and then you do an odd-even permutation of the indices. So you take first, third, second, fourth, and so on. And then, for this particular choice of course, you show that the resulting matrixization will be an identity matrix, and you will have exponentially flash that. That's the result of expressive power. It's actually very simple to prove. But in fact, it means, you may argue that, okay, it means that recurrent architectures, they have more expressive, they can represent much wider class of functions than the CDF. It doesn't mean they will work better for a particular set, but still. Then so that the connection tables for this event, okay, this is joint work with Reiner Kruskov and Alexander. So CP decomposition is the shallow network, CT decomposition is a recurrent neural network, HT decomposition is a convolutional neural network, and the red is the width. And there are also results by Grassi and Kruskov. There is also a recent paper by some Hungarian mathematicians. You also can bound the ranks between tensor train and pitch tacker. And this also shows how what is the difference between the expressive power. So for tensor train network, the rank is R, then for HT, it will be R to the power log to the end. That's the result. For CP it will be R, and for HT network, if HT network has an R, so the worst case will be R squared. And for CP you have exponential complexity also here. And from the viewpoint of learning such kind of models, so why it is better to use? Because now you go back from images using this feature map, okay, you still use some sigmoids there, but then you have to find out this coefficient tensor, and this coefficient tensor is given in the lower rank tensor format. And then we can use methods for solving problems with tensor decomposition. So there are many good algorithms for solving different kinds of problems, and that's the main motivation why such kind of models are used. So you can use additional linear algebra tools for that. Just run because in the previous talk, we were working on that, but maybe I will point out one important thing from the viewpoint of optimization. Although this is a non-convex story, there is an efficient Riemannian structure which can be used. And we tested this from practical viewpoint several times. So, and in fact, for tensor training and for HT, everything follows from the properties of the matrix. If you know something for the composition of the matrices, then you can find, maybe not in a fast way, but you can find an analogous result for these lower rank tensor decompositions. And for matrices, there is a lot of results, but still, for probabilities with classical convex optimization, although there are a lot of nice and efficient methods, but still people provide new methods and so on, and this is absolutely the same situation with matrices and linear algebra. Although everything should be known by now, I would not say almost nothing is known, but a lot of is not known, even for matrices. So that's a good thing about this thing. But still, what we know, we have best optimization by LCD. If you have the fixed rank R, the set of matrices of length R in the full hidden space of matrices of size n times m, they form a manifold. You can use the binding of integration levels. This thing I do not discuss, but it's very popular in application. There is a very nice convex relaxation given by nuclear norms. So you can, but this is the thing that is not generalized to tensors. So for matrices, nuclear norm relaxation works very well on their theorems, but for tensors, for example, for TT and HT, there is even a negative result, so there is no good convex relaxation that has the similar properties to the negative. The equation, but for matrices, it works very well. So you can just replace Lorentz constraint by Hopkin or and it works. And also cross approximation that allows you to efficiently sample then this sort of matrix to recover the fluid matrix. This is very efficient tool. Which in Genghis I also tried to popularize for for many years, not getting full attention that it deserves in the community. Many people, even in the algebra community, very from left, they still look at this, okay, what is this, we don't know, and so on. Although should be very good to understand the tool and not unknown to everyone, so let's introduce it once more. So every matrix of an car can be exactly recovered from RO's and ROs. This guy. So this is some matrix on the intersection. Well, if you look a bit more closely, this is just a new decomposition for four matrix with permutative columns and rows, so it's probably attributed to Gauss to avoid any. But as this is skeleton decomposition, the partition is the Marashkin vector. Was the first to show it to look at it as a matrix approximation tool. It's very, in fact, this formula is powerful. On the left side, you have n square numbers, but you know, you have an a priori knowledge that the matrix is rank r. So you can only compute r columns and r rows, and all other elements you do not need to compute, and you can recover the full matrix. Now, you do not compute all the entries of the matrix, you just compute columns and rows, and you recover the full matrix. So, okay, you do not encounter maybe a Lorentz matrix in practice directly, but you may have some blocks of Lorentz matrix and so on, but this is what you can keep in mind as an efficient approximation to. The question, of course, is how to sample these columns and rows, because if you have, what people typically say that want to prove that this method cannot work, right? Because how you can recover the full matrix without looking on every entry? Because I will spoil some element, and I will not tell you which element I will spoil. This will change the rank by one, but you will never find out. So if you artificially construct the matrix, of course such methods will not work, but if the matrix, for example, comes from some distribution, or it comes from some smooth function, the heuristics that we use work perfectly. So this is okay, and now we have new results, but this is also classical results. I think it's 2001. But I'm not sure. So if you have a maximum, this is an existing result, because exactly rank it doesn't happen in practice, and at least you have machine errors, but still this is okay. So there is some constant to the best approximation. And well, you can put Arminius from that, that's a perfect result. But also this gives you this maximum volume criteria for comparing some matrices. So although you don't compute the full matrix, if you compare one submatrix and another submatrix, and you compute the absolute value of the determinant, and you may say, okay, this one is probably better than this one. And this forms the basis for the simplest algorithm for optimizing the submatrix that you use. Now about this remaining optimization thing. So this Lorentz matrix for the main fold and the structure of this manifold is actually quite interesting. It's a non-linear thing, but it has a lot of linear flat parts. And the algorithms which optimize over this manifold with some constraints, they are not so well studied. So there are some partial results, but the good final theory which explains all the numerical results, I think that is about. But locally, what is happening, if you have a function, minimization of the function subject to Lorentz constraint, and this is a manifold, what you typically do, you take the step to the gradient, then you have the tangent plane. Okay, here on the picture, we don't have a tangent plane, but typically you will project the gradient onto the tangent plane of the manifold. And then you have to also to retract from the manifold, from the tangent plane to the manifold. And this gives you the first order gradient method, which is often quite effective. And honestly speaking, I do not have any explanation why it is so. Why it is better than just have gradient with respect to U and V. Okay. I don't do this thing. So in computation, it's typically better to use this kind of thing. But the review is, especially in computer science courses, they ask why it is better. I say, okay, maybe because you work in a few number of parameters, but this is not, strictly speaking, a mathematical result. So I don't have explanation why these methods are better than just using this parameterization. This parameterization is not unique. Ss minus 1 here, that means you have a whole line of extremal points. Probably this is bad for some sort of optimization, but again, how to prove? So the gradient, standard gradient type method is bad, and Riemannian is better, I don't know. Just as an example of X calculation, fashion my author is two nice formulas. So we use this just to solve some problem in natural language processing, and it shows one of the applications how you combine machine learning with lower end optimization. So you write your score function in terms of the scalar product of the feature map and the lower end tensor, and this is different. And the function now is the minimization problem over the set of matrices of n factors. So you can apply Riemannian optimization techniques. That's what we did. So people they are called as implicit matrix factorization. In implicit, because the matrix is factorized, but the loss function is some complicated loss function, which is got quadratic loss and so on. So you can optimize it still. But this is some technical details. It involves logarithms of the matrix elements. And you have to maximize this with respect to the matrix that you've got. And what we obtained, finally, so this is the topic of word embedding. Just a brief into this topic. You have words, and to every word you want to assign vector. And then if you want to find the semantically close word into the word, you just take scalar product between these vectors and find the closest vector in this space. You map the word into a vector space. And also people do some stupid things like, I don't know, they get Paris minus France plus England and they get London. So you may see this in the internet. So probably this is not the right explanation because you map words into a linear vector space. So there are other explanations for this fact. But for finding semantically close neighbors, and this loss function actually describes the word, and the context are the words that appear to the left or to the right of the particular word in the document. Left, right. And you count these pairs. And then this is just likely to that this word belongs to. And then we ask what you're saying, find the closest word. So this is our Riemannian optimization method, which gives almost all the states. And these guys, they do give the states for seeking semantic metric, we are better. But don't know how to value. We're also better in terms of quantitative metrics, but here this is visual. And this was published in a top conference on computational. And for tensors, actually what I will also briefly run through this. This is just an intro to the tensor training stuff, maybe outlining some things. So for our initial motivation for working with tensor factorizations, the starting point was of course CP, canonical periodic decomposition, this product thing that was used for many years in multilinear algebra. But it doesn't work so well. So this is CP, this is Taki. So the problem with CP is that best Rankine approximation may not exist. And if you work with matrices, the best Rankine approximation always exists and is given by truncated SVD. For CP decomposition, the set of tensors with bounded rank is not close. You will have a sequence of tensors of canonical Rankine, which converges to something else. It means if you want to find an approximation to such to the tensor on the boundary with rank, you will never find it. It's not a problem of having bad algorithm, it's just an ill-posed problem. So that's my favorite example. This is a 9999 tensor. And the slices, they're just three ones in each point. And then these three ones, they just go to this. This is directly related to the problem of matrix by matrix quantification. What is known that the rank is less or equal than 23. There exists a decomposition with 23 terms. and the lower bound I think is 20. But it is not known whether 21, 22 exists. There is a very small tensor for which we do not know what is the value of the canonical rank. So this is actually the question of if the system of polynomial equations has solution or not. And the number of variables here is several hundreds, and this is too complicated for any modern computer algebra. Unfortunately,
it is impossible to find the finite.
It is possible, yes. Good news, it is possible to find the finite number of iterations. Bad news, this is exponential in everything. So, you probably may use all. My guess is if you take the standard software and use all the supercomputer power in the world that is available, it's still not enough to solve the problem of high quantum computing. So, something else has to be done. And this is the example of some closest, a very simple one. You just take all the products of two vectors, A and B by B by B plus, and then this A goes from left to right. And you can take this auxiliary tensor, which is rank 1, and take its derivative with respect to T at 0. And the first term, the linear term is T, and then this is polynomial in T, then you can approximate with finite difference with any accuracy. So what you have some guy which has D terms, and here you can show by using tools of algebraic geometry that you cannot represent it with smaller number of terms. This is a part of some PhD dissertation defended in Stanford, Lansberg.
No algebraic geometry.
Okay.
Simple. It's not so simple. We did this book in Hamper on one conference, but it was not published.
Yeah, but I think it has this E dissertation.
It's five sentences.
So that you can show that this guy cannot be represented as gamma D, then minus one. Okay. We should publish
it.
So the statement is this.
Not enough for dissertation.
Well, it's a part of this, and I think this was one of the main results of the dissertation.
Lansberg has proved his dissertation right.
Not the PhD student, but his name is Lee, two letters. The statement is you cannot represent this guy cannot be represented with less than D terms. And this line shows it can be approximated with rank 2 with any. Exactly. So these are D rank 1 terms. Let's try to say that it can be represented exactly with D minus less than D rank 1 terms. That's the statement. Equivalent statement, the CP rank of the tensor is equal to D.
Yes, exactly. Okay, we need a simple analysis.
It seems to be related to the relationship for
yeah, but then was it's related, right? This is a particular example, not for example. Maybe you're right. Maybe you can show that there is a precisation of correct. No, but this is not superior. Actually, every mathematization of this tensor has rank 2, of course. Because the set of matrices is closed, and if it can be approximated by CP with rank 2 with any accuracy, it means that every matricization has rank 2. But there is no rank D approximation. That's another thing. And okay, suppose and then the approximation here is due to the difference between two very large numbers. This approximation is, of course, if h goes to zero, it becomes unstable. So in Belkin and Morium Kampf paper, which is one of the most motivating of this, where they basically show that we can use CP for approximation and everything, they use this example, and then they show that if you have a finite precision, then the canonical rank depends on the precision logarithm. So if you have double precision, the canonical rank is smaller. This quite strange that the approximation rather depends on the precision that we use. So to me it's one of the bad examples of this.
Is it not a contradiction to the situation?
No, this is this is not a contradiction. CPRM has a this is the motivation why you should use tensor. Actually, that's one of the reasons. So these guys are not continuous. And the set is not continuous. So if you try to find a funny exercise, try to find red two approximation to this guy. You will get decrease and at some point it will.
Maybe because it won't improve this.
This is not all.
No, it's the limitation.
Oh, they have the Zariski closure and so on, but so this example
it's not shown in it.
They have different types of closure, Zariski closure and so on. And that's what we did. So I will just show this to the historical part. So first idea was, okay, let's make matrix from a tensor, let's split the indices to the left and to the right and compute more factorization. And then the key idea is that we have one additional summation index and we just put it here. That was the first idea. If you do recursive, okay? If you don't put this in this here, you get complexity that is half to the power of t. But if you do it in a smart way, put this additional index to the tensor, you get cubic complexity. And this was this three-dicker format, okay? Have to put 2009 here. The preprint of this of Hakush and Punnett appeared the same week as our preprint of 2009. Then actually I found out it's much easier to work on the tensor training implementation. Because I was tired of coding these three structures and so on, found something much simpler. And we're still working on this tensor training. So there are some properties just like we use training. So first of all, you define unfoldings and the ranks, TT ranks are just the ranks of the system. You have to make it, you have the unfoldings, means everything is close and so on. But we have to prove it. And the proof is constructed with the object, which I will probably skip. And there is also a stability estimate, which I also did. I'm giving this talk about tensor training from 2009. But also there is a nice connection to quantum physics, which is also a motivating connection. So the meaning of the rank, of the splitting rank. So think of it as a system with d variables. You split it into two halves, to the left half part and to the right part. And if the rank is equal to 1, then it means that this function separates into the product, right? So if, remember physics, right? So if these are spins, and this is a wave function, so that means that the system has two independent parts. If the rank goes larger, then it means that two subsystems, they are what is called entangled. And in fact, what is meant by quantum entanglement, which means in physics, is directly related to the concept of tensor train rank and the H rank. This is the same story. If the rank is large, the systems are entangled. If the rank is small, it means it separates into a product, then the parts are not entangled. I don't know what is the direct the meaning of there is some funny consequence for neural networks. So there is a connection between neural networks and tensor factorizations, and you split your system into two halves in terms of pixels, it means you split your pixels into two parts. And for example, if you have a face, you probably split it into the left part of your face and to the right part of the face. These are probably not so entangled. But on the other part, if you have some local smoothness, you probably split it into odd pixels and even pixels. They are there. And since you have these unfoldings, and you can define signal values for these unfoldings, right? So you have a specific measure of how complex your system is. And you can measure what this network is more complex than another network in terms of signal values. Unfortunately, this only holds for this product units, it doesn't hold for standard real units. when you have other types of federation. So if it would be possible to generalize this possible possible benefit to other types of federation, it would be nice, but I don't know how to do that. Let's talk about that of trade gap. So if you have approximation, you can still compute something within an error bound. I don't know if this error bound is sharp or not. So probably it can be improved. Or, okay, there is no example where it is. And this is how you compute it. You basically take the matrix, you reshape it into n times all the rest, compute like SVT, take the left factor, which is now n1 times n2 and 3 times n4, you reshape it into the matrix, compute SVT. So this the first version maybe was in 20, 30 lines of one code. This is really simple to input at one side. You can do linear algebra, that's why it's important. So if you represent something in this format, then you can add them, and the result will also in this format. But for example, element-wise product is just going to the product, of course. So there are some multipliers, you have to push S, and you have this nice rounding procedure which can be done in linear and decomplexity. So you add things, and then okay, you have rank 100, you probably go back to rank 20 if you are playing. And the cross, and that's what we did. So, that's the result that I'm really proud of, because the physicists didn't know it for sure. They didn't have such a formulation. No physicist will recover the wave function from samples. But here, we put it in the same. We have the tensor, and we have an a priori knowledge that we can evaluate any particular element of the tensor. It's a very standard formulation if you have a subroutine that computes the function of many variables. From something that computes anywhere. In machine learning, it's called active learning. It's a very difficult problem, it's very difficult to solve. It's trivially to solve once we have the cross method in the tensor setting. If you have a Lorentz tensor, then you can sample d times n times absolute elements and recover the full tensor exactly. You do not have to have any basis, you don't have to have any interpolation points. You just interpolate the values of the tensor from some values of the tensor itself. So it's a purely algebraic, it's a linear algebra. So you can have heuristic algorithm for that. So there are different implementations, different groups right now. So but the basic theorem and the first algorithm also is given our paper in the LLA with English. And the QTT, which was already mentioned, historically it was also a very funny thing. I had a program that was very good at approximating 100-dimensional tensors, but I didn't have any 100-dimensional tensors to approximate. You do not encounter them in everyday life. So you have 2, 3, and then I started just making them artificially, just by reshaping everything into tensor. Fortunately, in MATLAB, it's very easy to do. You just run NP reshape. And the size, so if you take the function sine of x, you take the vector of values on the uniform grid, and reshape it into a tensor, and compute the decomposition. Also, 20, 30 lines of quantum code to expand, maybe a little bit less here. This is what we call now QTT format. Okay, what kind of user story about that? But it's actually a very nice format that approximates quite interesting classes of functions. So it's not directly related to smoothness, it's not directly related to Satori Gordon approximation. Because, well, for example, if you have an exponent, it's trivial to see it will give you rank 1. Because exponent of the sum as the product, and if you have binary indices here, it will just separate the two. If you have a side function which is highly similar, with any assimilation, you will still have rank 2. It's also easy to show. For polynomial, it's also easy to show the rank about it. The general result, if f of x plus y can be approximated by sum of rank 1 terms, you get the rank 1. So, for example, for rational function or for absolute value of x, you also have bound of x. So, it works with point by singularities and with uniform oscillations. And again, mentioned through Kozirik and Schwab, and they proved that there is a class of functions that come from the solution of specific elliptic partial differential equation, which can be approximated with this type of thing. And finally, you can solve optimization problems with low rank constraints. Well, in the same fashion we do it for matrices. What I like most of this remind instruction. So still there is a lot of room for new methods about Maxim Rakhimov, who came up with several ideas. But still there is this Riemannian structure, and there is an efficient way to compute the projection onto the tangent plane of the space. You can have this projection and the retraction, then you can run first order methods or conjugate gradient type methods and there are many unstated geometrical properties, etc. So we also have the software method kind of work for fancy tensor profile, which allows it by such variable, which allows it to be used for the GPUs for training for free, you don't have to go anything. We have several applications, I will not mention them all, I will give you only one example. But this is sort of toolbox, which using this toolbox, like you can build up different types of solvers for different types of problems. So, for example, Vladimir Kazeev used this toolbox to build a solver for chemical master equation in biology, which was 1,000 times faster than the state of the art. So Maxim Rakubov, he was using it for solving molecular problems. And many people use it, and so on and so on. So what this toolbox can solve, Gross method, it can solve linear systems. It can solve linear systems, they are given a matrix in this format, and you want to find the solution. Same thing, so typically you even don't need any preconditioner there, or except for your special cases if you want, but since you have an a priori knowledge that your solution lies in this small dimensional manifold, not in the full Hilbert space, but in the small dimension, the whole idea. Solution to this linear system can be approximated by a point on this manifold. This is a huge a priori knowledge which can be used in preconditioning. We also have efficient integrator in time, which was also used by physicists based on the ideas of Spitzer. Eigenvalues in linear systems. So for example, for this type of high dimensional eigenvalue problem, which with harmonic potential, something normal potential, for realistic, you cannot estimate how realistic is that, it was obtained from chemists. They for many years, for 20 years, they work only on this type of problems. And we just came by with our solver, put it into our solver, and got better results than they did. They were not very happy, and then they wrote maybe 10 more papers with better methods that we did, to the point with comparison. Really some crazy methods, which combine canonic or whatever. But still, published in a chemical journal. So my experience with publishing in a chemical journal is much better than publishing in a mathematical journal. It's much, much faster. In a mathematical journal, we have 2 years. So the paper on tensor free decomposition was in review for exactly 2 years. With five review cycles. That was already mentioned and cited many times, but the review was going on. And now it's stopped. It's only for compared, I know, yeah. No, but in chemical, you don't have. It can be stressful, you know. But, you know, if it's. No, I wouldn't say. Good papers always get more reviews. But, if you get a long review, it doesn't mean. Okay. And there's also ongoing work, which is not yet finished on some nonlinear solvers. So you see there's some complicated integral operators there. You have to put it into a solver, and these are all building blocks. Okay, you know, delete the picture from this, but we can solve quite efficiently on a very fine measure. And finally, so this is about optimization, and my talk is about deep learning. So shall I say a few words about our preliminary results in deep learning? Not directly related to tensors, but related to some open problems there, and also related to what I started from. So how mathematicians have to look at these things. So first is Boolean proof. It's also preliminary results on the so-called set points. I'm not sure if it's okay. So it probably won't work. Okay. No, it doesn't work. But this is actually a continuation of this work. So as we know, when we have a training set, and you have a test set. You fit your model on your training set, but you evaluate it on the test set. And if you have too many parameters, you will have what is called overfitting. Right? So you have very high accuracy on the training set, and you increase the number of parameters, and the accuracy on the test will go down. This is overfitting, and it's typical in machine learning. What we have in neural networks is exactly the opposite. You increase the number of layers, the depth, and both the train and test goes down. It's the opposite. there are millions of parameters in standard architectures. It means there is no, okay, there is most recent speculation, I would say, about information bottleneck. It's interesting, but it's not an explanation. Still, there is no theory of why it is happening, for which scenario it will happen. So you increase the number of parameters, and there is, but still, you get better generalization error. You can also do a very strange thing, and what these guys did, actually that's almost the whole content of their paper, is that they took the standard data set and put, okay, this is the picture of zero, and they say this is one. So you put random labels on each training set, random labels. And this is our training set. And still, this architecture has the memory to remember all these labels. So you get 100% training accuracy. Okay, it is slower, but still you get 100% accuracy. So it means the number of parameters is enough to memorize absolute, well, garbage. Absolute garbage. And if you remember about BC dimension, the BC dimension is huge. And it means it should overfit. But it means that it overfit on the real data. And then I think people will say, maybe there's a type of data we have. We have special subclasses of images which have smaller dimension and so on. Or this is the structure of the model. The model is so good that any local minimum is a global minimum. There is such paper. Okay, it has tens of assumptions that doesn't hold. But there is such paper that every local minimum is a global minimum and so on, with the probability one. Or you may say this is a fantastic stochastic gradient method that always finds the right one. But again, the simple experiment, which everyone who has this Python experience can recover, I show that these explanations are not true. You do not have to do any experiment. You can see that from logical things. So if it fits, and we actually did a very stupid, from the point of machine learning thing, we just put the test labels into the train set and assign correct labels to train and wrong labels to test. And it has a number of parameters and it learned it. Finally, this guy learned it. And you have a set of parameters that have 100% of training accuracy, almost 100% accuracy of training. But on any test, it produces zero accuracy of test. So it means it's a very, that's a very bad point. It's almost, well, it's not exactly the local minima, but it's a point where you have your good loss function that is very good on training, but on test is bad. But for some reason, you never fall into these points. You never, so such point exists, bad points, which provide bad generalization, but you never fall there. Probably they are somehow distant from the points and so on. So the idea is you can do it again without any. So the neural network has so many parameters that it can remember all the labels. So you have, you put X and Y, and you will have training to this 100. So you construct the test. You take the train set, you take the test with wrong labels. You create a new training set, and then you train this again the parameters. And what you get? You get. So the loss goes down and you get 100% here and almost zero. This is a very bad point. We found a local minima or something close to local minima. For some reason you never find it if you start just from random Gaussian guess. And it requires some explanation. Okay, these points are graded quite far. So they are, so the typical size is maybe 300. So these are bad, sad local minima, right? And they can be found, but for some reason we never fall into this problem. Yes, that's a problem. And finally, also, this has some flavor in algebra, but a few. You can also fool. These things are quite unstable. These things are quite unstable because you can fool them by using so-called adversarial examples. So you have not your neural network. And you take an image and produce a class. So what we want to do, this is what our idea, Jan Buchfeld, 2014, you perturb your image a little bit such that you get another class. So you have, I don't know, an image of Apple, and you perturb a little bit the pixels, and you want to get an image. So this is the Fourier rate. And our idea was very simple. Okay, this is some non-linear vector. We just linearize it and find a perturbation that maximizes a certain number. Well, you can do a two-norm, but for visual things, it's more natural to use infinity norm. So you get something what is called generalized singular vector. And well, there is a very simple generalized power method by Boyd from 1970s, how you compute the generalized singular vector of this guy. Well, this matrix is huge. So if this is infinity of infinity, there is a simple way to compute it, but you cannot access a full matrix, so you have to use a direct method. So we compute it, and that's what this one, the singular vectors, how they look like for different networks. So these are the singular vectors for different layers of the VGG architecture. This is for SNET. Well, and to our, so they are more visually appealing than the standard ones. I have to put the standard ones. The standard ones looks like the white box. These guys, they have some visually appealing patterns. So probably they are somehow related to the structure of the network. But also this perturbation are universal in the sense that you add them, sorry, so you add them to any, image to the data set, and the neural networks, and it is small, you usually cannot distinguish the image before and so on, the human will not distinguish, but the neural network is sensitive to this type of perturbation, it will change the class, so the Fourier rate is of order 60-70% with one image to all of the images, image to all in the direction that is probably in the direction of unnatural images which never come out of the photographer. And you get that this neural network is now completely useless. So it may be good for captures, for example. You have a neural network that solves captures very well. You add this. Okay, you have to know the weights of this neural network to optimize what is on your side of the text. Or you may want to, I don't know, train something on your face so you will not be recognized by video recognition systems or some evil leads. You can also do that. So they are not robust to small perturbations. If you want to artificially construct perturbation to an input vector to change the prediction, it can be done. It can be done. So it means so this architecture, so the generalized well on the data set that people have collected, they are not very robust to.
Can you explain the approach of the
So this is the output of the layer. So, and this is the Jacobian of this map, which you can evaluate using automatic differentiation, and this. And then you want to find the perturbation that maximizes certain norm. So it would be the two norm, this would be just the largest single vector of the Jacobian. And you can use it solving power methods. So for power method, you need the product of the Jacobian times vector and the transpose of the Jacobian times vector. You can do it both using this automatic differentiation, both quite simple.
Just
here you
layer,
no, we tested for different layers. So for example, this is for, this is for some convolution, different convolution, this is some Fourier layer. So for different layers, you get different adversarial examples.
So you mean that if we have different points, different colors, you step a little bit, yes, and you go to a different class.
Yes, example, so, no, this is something that you have to add to your picture to multiply this by a small weight. I also have to add it to some perturbed features. So you multiply it by a small weight and you add to the original image. So maybe if you look closely, you will see some artifacts on the image, but you will clearly understand what is shown on the picture. It basically means that your separation decision boundary is not smooth, it's like this. Right? And you may find a perturbation in this high dimensional space which was not in your data set. Right?
Is it somehow close to
dropout? Well, dropout is a way to regularize, to avoid overfitting, actually, to speed up learning. But this neural networks, they have your power, so it's not so important. So the ways that they don't get the dropout, they can be fooled universal. You can also take this picture and put it to another network, it will still.
So maybe even made some regularization.
Yeah, so the next step is making some regularization to make it smaller, right? But it's computationally not so easy. You can try to regularize to make the output of the layer smooth with respect to the to the input. You can use that we did not do that yet. And this is becoming technically complicated because if you use this thing as a regularization, you need to differentiate singular values, and even for two optimizing singular values is not an easy story. It's a difficult thing. Yeah, but the next step is try to regularize to avoid such kind of attacks. And then you can attack the new regularized architecture. Yeah, but I'm actually done. Summary, so there were actually several questions to talk. But still, this is, I think we're getting closer to merge these things together. So we started from some vague ideas, now we have some specific results. And there is a huge open problem about generalization. I think it's quite disturbing that no reasonable result in generalization. So you increase the depth and you get better generalization error. That's what really to what you should have from variance bias results. And it's absolutely not clear what is the source. Okay, thank you. Or everything that these people are doing makes no sense.